Hey, everybody. We are here with Shane Black, legendary director of the upcoming film, The Predator. Thank you for joining
us. Thank you. I'm pleased to be here.
What was it like revisiting the franchise after so many years?
The whole point of it was that the nostalgia of, at first, just wanting to go back to a time which was particularly magical.
Yeah.
You know, I was 20-something years old. I had Lethal Weapon going on and the Monster Squad and then The Predator. And it was just such a great period of being green and anxious and wide-eyed. And not having really done any of it before. And now, here, I'm in my 50s now, and I felt like a midlife crisis coming on. So I called my friend Fred Decker, mm-hmm. who wrote The Monster Squad.
Absolutely, greatest movie ever made.
And I said, you want to be like, maybe like a kid again? Let's Predator number one was a piece of pure pulp,
yeah,
right?
For sure.
It incorporated the Rambo craze and the science fiction aliens craze of the 80s. And with a wink to and a nod to the idea that these are larger than life characters with big muscles and impossible guns, it was just the most purely pop art shape you could conceive of in the best way the 80s knew how to do that. I thought, wow, you know, it'd be so much fun in this CG infested world of, you know, if to go back and try to make a shape that's pure like that. That's sort of a love letter as best we can to the original, and he agreed that would be a fun thing to do.
You've got a killer cast with the Loonies, though. Did you start with that concept and work backwards? How did that really work?
We knew we wanted a unit of strange people. And the fun part is, it's not about the jokes. It's not about finding comedians. For instance, Keegan-Michael Key, known as a sketch comedian. No, he's a Shakespearean-trained actor, and I think one of the best there is. He steals any scene he's in. We thought, let's make it organic. We're going to try to establish a camaraderie among these weird guys, and if we could organically find that group and create a team that you want to spend the afternoon with and relate to, then maybe when they start getting sliced and diced, you'll give a little bit more.
I want to ask you, what's it like looking back, all this time has passed, looking back on the role of Hawkins, your experiences on the set, like, does that even seem like it was this same lifetime?
No, like I said, it's this sort of wondrous sort of waking dream that I, you know, stumbled through when I was a kid. And it feels like I wanted to go back to it. I thought it would be a lark. I'd be a kid again. That was a mistake. It's not a lark. And 2.5 years later, it's like, raining on me in Vancouver with the CG green screens falling over. It's like, yeah, that was a fun lark. I remember it so fondly because of the guys. Carl's still out there. Bill's still out there. Of course, Kevin Peter Hall is not with us anymore. It was just such a fun, perfect group. And people you wouldn't expect to be so gracious. I was so intimidated, for instance, by Jesse Ventura. My parents came down, and the first thing he did is his wife, Terry, and he said, hey, come to dinner with us. And they treated my parents this huge feast and stayed with us all night. Like, why did he do that? He's a movie star. They were just great people.
Do you have amazing stories from shooting in that location versus up in Canada?
I have stories about, you know, some of the more iconic lines in the movie, like when he says, Major, there's something in those trees. He was holding back a dump because we all had fucking dysentery. So he's like, Major, there's some of the trees ain't no man. And the cut, he's like, oh, Jesus. But some of the most steely-eyed, tough guy lines were followed by a mad dash for the toilet.
I have heard that a lot of Hawkins' iconic lines, which I will not repeat right now, were ad-libbed, that a lot of those you were making up on the spot.
Well, I wasn't making them up so much as recounting jokes that I was particularly fond of, that I'd heard, yes. But see, they brought me down there maybe to say, maybe you can rewrite some of the script. Now, I knew for a fact that, you know, there have been efforts to rewrite the script and jazz it up, and none of them seemed to work. And I thought to myself, you know what? It's because they're going to go back to the original script, and the original script is going to be fine, which it was. But when it came to my own participation, I thought, well, I could write a couple lines for me. And so I didn't even think they'd get in the movie. That's the thing about John. I told him those jokes. He goes, put them in. John had this sense of knowing how far to push things. And just he would get tickled by something, and he would include it. And you wouldn't think it would work, but it did.
We have something fantastically incredible that I believe you've never seen before. And it's, I don't know, the greatest Hawkins figure in the history of humanity.
These are awesome. I mean, who the hell wouldn't want to be a really well-made action figure?
Yes, this is a limited edition NECA Hawkins action figure here. So these are pretty hard to come by. And we're actually doing sweeps on the app where we're going to be giving some of these away. Now officially signed by Mr. Shane Black.
This, to me, is almost worth the pain and misery of a career in show business.
Thank you all so much. Thank you, Shane Black, for joining us on
it's been a pleasure.
Very
Thank
special
you.
Shane Black edition of The Rundown.